Hi, good evening. Is this adjusted right? Thank you all for coming and welcome to the New York Society Library. I'm Jean Pfeiffer and I've been a trustee here a long time. And I've been a friend of Betsy's and a colleague of hers for even longer. So I'm delighted to introduce her to everyone, although I know she hardly needs an introduction and everyone here knows very well her great accomplishments. But first, let me just ask everyone to remember to turn on your cell phones and pagers, and also to mention that there are copies of the book Green Metropolis for sale out in the lobby, and Betsy would be happy to sign copies after her presentation. On behalf of the library, I wanted to thank everyone for coming tonight and hope that you will remember to contribute to our annual fund, which helps support events like this and keeps us open 7 days a week. So let me get onto the business, which is to welcome Elizabeth Barlow Rogers. She is a native of San Antonio, Texas, and she has lived in New York City since 1964. And she made her name in New York, most famously, I think, as Central Park Administrator and one of the founders of the Central Park Conservancy. And she served in that position from 1979 to 1996, and that's when I was privileged to work with her on the Central Park Master Plan and several other buildings that had been restored, and we were just laughing how so many buildings in the park are still being restored, like the police precinct on the 86th Street Transverse. Finally got done after 30 years or so of our first efforts to do so. So Betsy is now the president of the Foundation for Landscape Studies. She's written 9 books, which focus on, I love this subtitle, Nature, History, and Design. That really explains her work. Two of my favorites, which I hope you will read if you haven't, are The Forests and Wetlands of New York City, written in 1971, before urban ecology was even on the radar for most people. And then her wonderful Landscape Design, A Cultural and Architectural History from 2001, is really a comprehensive history of landscape design and beautifully illustrated as a reference book, so everyone should have that. So in Green Metropolis, Betsy literally revisits her interest in the ecology of New York City, and she looks at current efforts to preserve and restore the natural settings of New York in public parks in the 5 boroughs. And one thing that's really great, I think, about this book is that she talks about the people who are doing this work, and she goes into great detail about individuals in all 5 boroughs, and some of them are arborists, some of them are ecologists, some of them are sociologists, but just to really talk about those very important people. So thank you, and welcome Betsy.
Really a wonderful evening and wonderful for me to be here. This is a kind of second home, I think, for many of us here in New York. To give you an idea of what this book is all about, I'm going to tell you my life story. Well, with just a few relevant. I grew up in San Antonio, Texas, where I was a nature-loving child, collecting fireflies and pill bugs in the backyard and roaming around on weekends in the summer at my family's ranch in the Texas Hill Country. Can you hear me? There. Better? When I became a teenager, my interests were more focused on dating boys and making little excursions in nature, but this early love of the green outdoors was too ingrained to be lost forever. After I graduated from high school in San Antonio, I attended Wellesley College, where I majored in art history. Upon graduation, I got married, like most of my contemporaries, spring by spring, and at the age of 22, I became a mother. In 1961, at the same time that my first husband, Ed Barlow, was enrolled in Yale Law School, I decided to get a master's degree in city planning. Following our dual graduation in the spring of 1964, we moved to New York with our then six-year-old Lisa, where I, like so many others, enthusiastically adopted this as my permanent home. No Catholic, like a converted Catholic, no New York. And since my focus at Yale had been on landscape preservation in urban areas, I joined the Parks Association, now known as the New Yorkers for Parks. There's Lyndon Miller. This gave me my first taste of how citizens could enter into a relationship with government through a combination of advocacy and protest. The environmental movement was not yet born, as Jean mentioned, because of the encroachments on natural areas that needed to be stopped, I soon found myself protesting the smothering of Pelham Bay Park's remaining wetlands with garbage and marching with the Staten Island Citizens Planning Committee to prevent Robert Moses from building a highway along the island's central woodland spine. And there you will see in my second chapter of the book, we'll visit the Staten Island Greenbelt. And if you look at that map, you'll see that it has the Reed's Basket, Willow Swamp, the William G. Davis Wildlife Refuge, and High Rock. High Rock Nature Center. It is one of the city's most extraordinary natural landscapes, and you will find a chapter devoted to High Rock Park in Green Metropolis. This, along with other experiences as a park activist in the 1960s, made me familiar with a number of still green parks in each of the city's five towns, that so much nature could exist in such a densely urbanized place is what provided the impetus for writing The Forests and Wetlands of New York City. Now, this latest book is born out of a desire, I think you said this already, but I'll repeat, a desire to revisit these areas that I had written about earlier. And since the publication of Forests and Wetlands 45 years ago, the century, this is really hard to believe. I was a very young thing. there's been additions to this fabulous 29,000 acre park system. And I wanted, therefore, to write about the older parks, revisit those, and write about the newer parks as well. And not all of them, there's only seven chapters really devoted each to a specific green area and park. And you'll find them, the additional ones, besides Inwood Hill, High Rock, Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge. You'll find, I wrote this time about the Central Park Ramble and Four Freedoms Park out in the East River Roosevelt Island, it's called, and the FDR Monument on Roosevelt Island. And I also wrote about the High Line and the new park on Staten Island, Fresh Kills Park, which is the story of garbage. And then, as many of you know, there was a 20-year hiatus in my career as a writer. And then my writing was mostly grant proposals and annual reports of the Central Park Conservancy. And then the book called, this was important, Jean brought this up, Jean was part of this, the management and restoration plan for Central Park. And that really was a wonderful 20-year period of my life as we started the restoration that, as Gene and I were remarking, it is ongoing. We're re-restoring some of the things that you worked on way back when, because the park has never been better managed than it is now. And I really have to say that my legacy is very much due to people that I hired a long time ago and other people that they hired. And I get wonderful compliments, particularly every spring. I think I planted every, painted every blossom on the cherry trees, but that's not true. It's really being, it's the best managed park in America. It's the best managed park in the world, and it still owes a lot to that plan. And having a good plan to guide its, not just the restoration, but look why we put the word management first. It has to be managed. And that is where this happened, and it's a joy. I did go on, I felt that my talent really is more entrepreneurial and literary, and that it was time for the, the whole professional administrative aspect to come before, and that is indeed what's happened. And I'm happy that this book that you also mentioned is now being used in universities and colleges where there are art history departments and landscape architecture departments as a text where they have survey courses. And here, back to the book of the day, the book of the evening tonight. It's about cities, parks, and the other one is about cities, parks, and gardens. This one is, I think what you know already what it's about, so I'm going to leap forward with telling you that you have New York City. First of all, I just want to say that New York City is not a place where nature is scarce at all. You can take a walk in a remote-seeming location like High Rock Trail on Staten Island. You've got all of this wonderful riverside, 500 miles of waterfront in New York. You have biking, you have canoeing and kayaking, you can even sail, swim in the Bronx River now. So there is an awful lot of green New York and a lot of recreational opportunities within that. And think of it, you can take the A line and the final stop is Inwood Park in Manhattan, right at the tip of Manhattan, and you're in a beautiful park, another woodland, and you can see there in here, this is called the Indian Cave, this overhanging piece of Manhattan, just not really a cave, but it has a recess there, and you know, people like to fantasize that it was an Indian cave. But what's really interesting, of course, is the fact that Native Americans did live in this area on the shore, and they would probably shelter in the winter right there, which is why it's appropriate that it's called the Indian Cave. And we have Jamaica Bay, and there it is, right by, you can see, if you fly into Kennedy, you look down and you can see all those marshes in the bay, and it's amazing to think that right there, you can have this abundance of wildlife, primarily birdlife. And the person that, I'll get to Don Reapy in a minute, but he said that when he got tired, he was a ranger for many years, and he is heart and soul, guardian of the bay, and he said when he got, not, you never get tired of watching birds, but he would watch the planes, and he can identify every plane. And he misses the Concorde, because it's no longer up there to be. So identifying the planes, that's another challenge. And here is an osprey nest. The raptors came back. If you remember, all bald eagles and all kinds of hawks and osprey were very endangered. And then after Rachel Carson's Silent Spring and the banning of DDT, we do have this wonderful, thrilling comeback. And the same person that looked for the planes as well as the birds, he built these platforms, which are great nesting areas. So you can see lots of osprey now in Jamaica Bay. But now, take a drive over the Verrazano Bridge, or you can, of course, take the Staten Island Ferry. And Staten Island is just a great place. This is not in my book, but I think this is worth mentioning, the Chinese Scholar Garden and the Tibetan Museum. And of course, my favorite place is High Rock. And here, I do bring in, as I think you mentioned, these are my gurus, the people who really were my my mentors. And I had been to these areas, I'm familiar with them, but there's something about the people who are real habitués, who are in these parks every day, and who can reveal things to you. And Mike Feller is a very special guy, I think. Mike was officially, his title was naturalist in the New York City Park Department. He has retired now from the Park Department, but he's still very active as a New York City naturalist. And this was very thrilling. With Mike, we went to see the emergence of the 17-year cicadas. I knew about the cicadas because when I wrote The Forest and Wetlands, there was the story of the cicadas. Another naturalist had told me about how important this was and how it's just an amazing event. So I went over, and it's called stridulation. All of this, you know, humming and buzzing and very weird, loud sound. And I think Ted was with me too. And we went over and we met Mike, and here's Mike's photograph of one of the cicadas emerging. And I describe all of that in the book. And then, though, the heart is always never far from mine from Central Park. So The Ramble is a chapter that it was not in the Forest of Heaven, so I thought The Ramble really deserved its own chapter in this book. And here, look at this. The book, by the way, has a lot about geology. And because you have to know the bones of the city, what shapes a city, its geography and its topography. A lot of that is geology. And New York has an amazing geological history, and it's easy to read, and particularly in Central Park, where you have the outcrops, these wonderful outcrops of Manhattan Schist, one of the three formations. There's Fordham Gneiss, you'll see that mostly in the Bronx. Inwood Marble, you'll see that in the Inwood District near Inwood Park, and Eichen Park, actually, right outside the entrance to Inwood. And you'll see in Central Park the Manhattan Schist, and you'll see that in Inwood too. You'll see it, you know, in various places. But the glacier, the last period of glaciation, the rocks were formed hundreds of millions of years ago, and then these are, think of them. This is crustal plate theory, the mountains being heaved up, and this is part of the Appalachian chain. They erode, they wear down, then they're polished by the glacier. The last, most recent, I shouldn't say the last, the most recent epoch is when, in the Pleistocene, you had this 1,000-foot-high wall of ice just moving across the landscape, and you can see the south easterly trending grooves, and that marks the passage of the ice, and then it stops. And what you have then is the Staten Island is part of the terminal moraine, all of Long Island. The reason the north part of Long Island is ridgy and hilly, and the south part is this flat outwash point from the glacier. That does, that's why that topography is the way it is. And so here, take you into the rim, where the rim has really the best rocks. You have to realize that the park is totally man-made, that it was, they blasted these rocks, it was like a quarry in a way, so lots of rocks. Look at the Belvedere, you look at all these buildings, look at the wall, look at, you know, the sides of the transverse road. These are right there in Central Park. These are pieces of Manhattan schist that then was the stonemasons. You know, they dressed the stone and they used it as building blocks, but then they also, and this is the genius of Frederick Law Olmsted and Calvert Box, is leaving some of these magnificent outcrops in place. And so here we have the gill, and it just, they use the little crevice and it flows right through the ramble. And the ramble also, talk about the botanical epochs of Central Park, the picturesque original park with vines, and the ramble was very romantic. And then we have the turn of the century, you're importing more plants, and it gets a little more showy with some of these exotic species. But now we have what I have called in the book eco-culture, because it's about the native plants that are being planted today in the way of managing the park. And here, oh, let me see if I can identify this one. Roger Pascagnan, of course, is here. And Roger has a, you have a cameo appearance in this book, and Roger is the ultimate guru. And so here we have Northern Flicker. It used to be called a yellow shaft, but now it's just known as Northern. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, I'm always a little insecure. That's right. Here, the rocks. Look at the way in which you can see that these beautiful, beautiful rocks are these great, I call them elephantine presences there in the ramble. But look what's happened here. Oopsie, the side of that rock, they've sheared it off a bit so that it makes a wall then as you go along the pathway there. Here, I mentioned earlier, the stone was dressed and used as building material, and I love the way that the Belvedere, it seems to grow right out of Vista Rock. Vista Rock, there are not many buildings, and the point of Central Park was it was to be scenic and picturesque, but where you do have a building, this particular one, the Belvedere, is it's like an exclamation point in the landscape. So you do have this sitting atop this rock, and it is a scenic viewpoint. You could see it originally from the mall. It was on the axis with the mall. There is the gill. Again, notice how that building material is used. You see, you would think this is a natural stream, but it really is completely man-made. So when you see, here I have a pointer there. There's my pointer, look. You can see all these rocks. That's all part of that blasted material that is put there to create the little mini waterfalls. And here's another of my gurus. And I'm sorry the guru isn't here tonight. He's come to some of my other talks, and he's my grandson, and he's in Manitoba. And Henry is now at Columbia. You know Henry Roger, and he's getting his PhD in geology. And this was really wonderful. He did have a job first. After he got out of Oberlin, he worked for 2 years at the Museum of Natural History. So he would just come over and meet me in the ramp. And we would go around and he would explain things. And I, you know, I told you a little bit ago about the rocks being molten and the bowels of the earth and being formed and then passed over by the ice. And I thought I sort of had the geology story in my head, but it turned out that Henry really had to explain the recrystallization of the minerals and how this all happened. And I'd never taken chemistry, you know, and it was really tough. So he kept explaining, I kept asking more questions, he kept explaining, and finally I looked and said, Grandma, you didn't get it right. So the last email, he really explained it, and I thought, this is good. Cut and paste. So it's not plagiarism, but it's definitely in his own words. So we got that story right. And here I mentioned the eco-culture. This is, and the wonderful people who stayed in Central Park. She is Regina Alvarez. Lyndon, you know Regina very well. And Regina, we hired as woodland manager way back when. And Daniel Atha, do you know him from the Botanical Garden? He's in the herbarium there. And what they are doing right now is they are collecting all of the self-propagating plants in Central Park, and they're being put in the dried specimens into the New York Botanical Gardens herbarium. So we hung out a lot in the Ramble, and Regina's the one who really knows all those plants because she planted many of them herself when she was the woodland manager. And here's Neil Calvinese. Oh, look, Linda is sighing. We miss, Neil was there for 35 years, and I remember he was just a young fellow right out of one of the degree granting programs of SUNY in horticulture. And he was our first group of we call them interns back then. And then he went on to become in charge of all the park horticulture and ultimately park management. And so here you can see this eco-culture that we're talking about. And it's so beautiful. If you remember the Japanese knotweed, you know, it sounds very racist to say an invasive exotic. I mean, that's it sounds so politically incorrect. But this plant is really a great spreader. And it's not that it's ugly, it's just that it takes over everything, and did. And so by removing the knotweed, which is a multi-year project, because it's everything is done very sensitively in the Ramble in terms of its restoration, because there are so many bird watchers, and so we have a woodland management committee, and Regina and other conservancy employees work very closely with them. And so this is what's happened. Instead of Japanese knotweed, you have pockets of this throughout the Ramble. You also have a lot of dead trees because a rotting log, obviously it's humus, it goes back into the soil, and it provides a lot of insects, the habitat for insects, and of course that's food for birds. And we have birds. And we don't even need watcher to identify this one. I found out something really interesting. The Baltimore Oriole, this was Lord Baltimore's colors. So, I mean, it didn't come from Baltimore, Maryland. It really is because this is crest, I guess, it, you know, the colors of the Baltimore family. And so that's why it's the Baltimore Oriole. We have the Magnolia Warbler. We have just a host of warblers, of course, that come into the park every spring. And I'm sure some of you have been on these terrific walks. I hung out some with Roger, but also Joe DiConstanzo from the Museum of Natural History. The museum offers walks, weekly walks in the spring and the fall. You're nodding, maybe you've taken when people sign up, and it's really great. And so I went out with Joe, and it was sort of like going out with Roger because I would be excited, and I came home, and there were 12 birds that I had seen. Well, then I would open up his blog, and there were 43 birds on the blog. This is just by way of saying how green this city is. And I mentioned it before, but here, Brooklyn Bridge Park is not in the book, but I'm bringing it up because it's just a marvelous addition to the city. There's Hudson River Park. We talked about you can go canoeing in the Bronx. And the High Line, of course, is a wonderful addition to the city. To think of taking an old industrial relic and turning it into this aerial promenade is great. That's Robert Hammond. And Robert is also a San Antonian, as I am, and it's just a great story. And I told a behind-the-scenes story. You know, we've all heard about the Dillard Scofidio and then James Corner. He's in the book. He's the field operations guy. It's brilliant, their design. It's really wonderful. I wanted to tell that story, but also how those two guys did it. I mean, they were just amazing to see that this most remarkable thing could come to be. And so their story is in the book. Robert and Josh David is his co-founder. They always never took any other title other than co-founder of the Friends of the High Line. And you can see with Linda knows Pete and Mary Smith, I'm sure, Pete Outoff well, the great Dutch plantsman designer, garden designer, and he planted. It was just brilliant to take the whole idea of this serendipitously revegetated, vegetated, it had never been vegetated. Just after the rail line was abandoned, up through these rotting railroad ties and in the tracks, grew these wonderful plants. And now in the plant pouch of the High Line, they aren't exactly the same, but they look like wild plants, even though some of them are, you know, pretty great horticultural specimens. But that's the genius of great garden design. And this is designed as a really fabulous garden, but you're not aware of it as, you know, garden. And then for Freedom's Park is another terrific park, and right there in the middle of the East River. It's essentially a greensward, and the French would call this a tapis vert. Think of Versailles and the, you know, line of the alleys of trees on either side. And that is a really interesting story about the old, when I wrote The Forest and Wetlands, if you look back in that book, you'll see then it was just changing from Welfare Island into Roosevelt Island. And so there's lots of rubble, and even because it was used as hospitals for contagious people with contagious diseases, and there were abandoned wheelchairs. I mean, it was really weird and interesting to go over there back then. Then the new town, it's called New Town, End Town, of urban planning. I think it's a success story that grew up there. William Vandenhoevel is really, in a certain way, the father of Roosevelt Island. He suggested to John Lindsay that it be named after FDR, his great hero from days of his childhood. He was a great admirer of FDR, and so the name was changed, and then the great memorial designed by Louis Kahn was designed in 1973, and it was going to be built, but then Colin died, and the city had financial troubles. This was before the fiscal crisis in the 80s, but there was state money and city money that didn't materialize. So it's over 40 years now since that was first proposed, and the fact that that was realized. It's like the story I was telling about Central Park, the fact that these things can come to pass that are the dreams of yesteryear is really wonderful. And so here we do have, this is Colin's memorial, the park is his too, the whole thing. And that's the smallpox hospital up there, which remains as a ruin. I think that's nice to leave that. And here it's, Colin called it a room, and it's open-sided, open, roofless, but then the side that's open is looking out at the most incredible views of the United Nations and the fabulous skyline that we know so well. Now, Fresh Kills Park is on Staten Island, as I mentioned, and that chapter is all about garbage and how the city's once vast wetlands have been completely consumed by so-called sanitary landfills. And it's a different sort of park from the kind that Robert Moses, see, Moses would have capped over, Moses was, well, as you know, he designed, Moses is really, he's a hero in some ways. I mean, all of the recreation that he brought to the city, the pools, the beaches, the, you know, golf courses is here. We know that he was very autocratic and really did some things later, particularly that were finally not in the best interest of having a vibrant, well, it was always vibrant, but I mean, when we read Jane Jacobs later, we realize that there are other ways to build and to restore in this city than tearing down and building. However, look at these were kept marshes. I mean, they were marshes that then had garbage dumped on them. Then it was capped, then soil was brought in, and then recreation facilities. Fresh Kills is not going to be that kind of park. There it's being kept. The four major, huge mounds, this is the last and the largest of the great marshes that were obliterated. And here we have polyurethane, or, you know, being spread like a blanket, and then more soil will be brought in. But then you have all that methane down beneath the ground, and so it has to be released. And it will be 30 years before the park is actually open to the public. They do have Parks Department, that's what they call a sneak peek, and that's once a year, and so you can go out there, and it's really fun. Climbing on these mounds, these great, I mean, it's, you see again, like the High Line, nature's just taking its course. And so you've got this, there's the skyline of Manhattan, and then all of this wonderful waving grass in the wind. And there you, on the edge, you have, it's just Arthur Kill, or no, it's which Kill is it, the Dutch? I'm losing this. But there you have the waterway going through this landscape, the big creek that the Dutch called Kills. And here is methane being processed in this plant, and then some of it, I mean, some is being released through the pipes, but other methane gets pumped into this plant and then distributed as electricity on Staten Island. So there is some environmental good that is going on. But now, I was babbling on about methane and gases and all those things. So enough of that. I'm just going to say my last word. Some of have to show you one more picture of Central Park and one more picture of a book which has green and red on it, if you're thinking of Christmas presents. Nice colors. But no, whether you want to buy the book or not, it's a really great treat for me to talk about my favorite subject, the parks of New York. Thank you. I've stunned everybody in this room. Yes, in the back.
Would you like to comment on
that? You know, I have a couple here. Do you have a thing? You're having it. Okay, well, you have to stand up and really speak loudly.
Okay, would you like to comment on the sequential failures of all of the restaurant facilities in the park?
Okay.
And how
the what kind of thing in the park?
No, I don't really know why they have failed. I can't tell you that. I'm sorry. You'll have to ask the concessionaire. Yes?
Have you done any research on rooftop spaces?
Rooftop spaces.
Rooftops. Well, I think rooftop spaces are great. They can be parks themselves almost, and I know people who have gardens on their rooftops and are gardening away and part of the local food movement, and I think New York, that's a great question because it does bring up the greenness is not all on the ground. We do have greenness, we have our penthouse terraces, we have a lot of green rooftops. And I know you're speaking of the kind where it's energy efficient, and we have that too.
What's the plan for Fresh Kills? Is it going to be a park or a natural area?
It's really called a park. It's called Fresh Kills Park. But it will be a natural area in the sense that it's really interesting. This is designed, the term design with nature is something that naturalistic design, and a lot of us are very big proponents of that. This is really not, it is designed with nature, but it's almost designed by nature, because nature is just being allowed to redeem this site, if you will, this great garbage dump. And so it's being carefully kind of nurtured. You're nurturing nature along for over 30 years. But it's an interesting plan. I won't be here to see it, but maybe our grandchildren will, and you can see it. I mean, it's fun to go out there. It's just that the admission, it has to be limited because of all this, activity with the sanitation department. Still, it's officially department property, but the sanitation people are still there because they manage all of that, so the elimination of the methane. Yes?
How do you feel about dogs and the parks?
Do I feel about dogs? I should ask Ted, who's right behind you. He never met a dog on his morning runs in Central Park or anywhere else in the city that he didn't want to say hello to. And I think dogs are great, and I think that the Central Park Conservancy's done a brilliant job of having the dog. We don't ever want dog runs in the park, because that's doing something that is very wrong, in my opinion, which is sequestering pieces of a multi-use public park, a special interest use. So I think that the way in which the dogs are allowed in some places and not in others, and that land pieces of very damaged lawn are restored and dogs go somewhere else, but all of that is the art of park management, and the dogs are considered as, you know, an element of that. Maura.
I have another question about fresh kills. You said that the garbage was capped over, so, and then soil put on top of that. So I'm just wondering about the technology of that. Is rainwater then allowed to go through the capping to kind of return it to a sense of marsh, or does the rain simply pour off the whatever is used to cap?
We need an engineer. We need an engineer. I don't want to give you bad information. I do know that there's plenty of water. Does anybody else have an answer to that?
Yeah, you have an engineer over here.
Oh, I'm a geologist, actually. So the capping is impermeable, but then they put a lot of soil on top of the capping, so its natural habitat is above it.
Yeah.
You don't want that cap to puncture, because then you're exposed to all the garbage and contaminants that are underneath it. So the purpose of the capping is to keep the two environments.
It's that layer of topsoil. I mean, here's the thing.
Yeah.
You can't plant big trees there,
right,
because the roots would go down. So when we saw all of the grasses are growing on the soil. So it's a soil surface. Yeah, I should have known that. I did know that. But then you don't plant trees because you don't want that barrier.
So my first question was, you know, what are they going to do with it? So do we see the possibility of going sled riding there in 30 years, because it is a big hill? Is that part of the use of it? Or are people going to be walking up this several hundred foot tall?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, I think they're probably still going to sled on Pilgrim Hill and Cedar Hill in Central Park. I don't want to, you know, make a guess. But that's what's so wonderful about parks, is that people find all sorts of uses, and uses that you wouldn't expect. And that's what makes them really wonderful, is that people find in these parks their own special interest. So whether it's sledding or biking or bird watching or meditating, the parks are there for all of us, and they serve us in so many different ways. Yes.
I'll just comment that this library has some wonderful sources on at least Central Park. I haven't checked the others, but when I was doing some work for my own neighborhood history, they have a tree census of Central Park in, I'm remembering, 1888, and then another tree census of Central Park in the 60s. And you can go through, and for the area that I lived in, you know, you can trace which ones have spawned, which ones have died, and they have a lot of colorful stories about how different trees got there. So anyway, the library is a great source to bring to preface your book.
Oh, this library is so great. And I have done research here too, and I found great material on Central Park here. But also in writing the Forests and Wetlands, a little book about the springs of Manhattan that come out of the ground, that is in my bibliography. And I mean, many books that are really very precious and tell about the parks, because this is the New York Society Library. Yes, Charlene.
As the water rises, and as it's going to rise, how have they protected all the investment in Roosevelt Island and all the parks along the rivers? How is that being protected for the future?
I'm not sure.
Can you repeat the question?
How is it being protected for the future?
Meaning, how will it not be flooded?
Oh, how will it not be flooded? You know, really, you're coming at me with these questions about, no, when I said engineering, and then we figure that one out. Okay. You want some help on the, give me some help on the, no, this is really an issue. And it's a great issue. because we are in the midst of climate change. There's no question about it. I'm not sure what in our lifetime is going to be done that makes a difference, but I do know that today landscape designers are designing with some kind of flood control mechanisms in mind. Yes?
So to follow up on that, they are planting saltwater resistant plants on the land, along the edge now, and something new since Sandy. And it brings up what my question was. I took part in the hearing that City Council just held on inaccessible places in our city parks. And I brought up the Stanton Building on the Lower East Side, which is inaccessible now, but could be a fantastic location for a resiliency center. Do you think parks in the future are not just going to be teaching us about the environment, but also teaching us about sustainability and resiliency?
Yes, I do think that that's a great mission for parks. Linda, do you want to say something about New Yorkers for Parks and how the advocacy for sustainability and we do have community gardens, don't forget, and with local food movement is certainly thriving in New York. But how do you feel about the future of parks and their educational potential for sustainability?
The important thing is that we must get the city to provide the resources to maintain these places. Mayors, the recent ones, build huge parks, and certainly Brooklyn Bridge Park is to die for, it's so beautiful. But it's terribly concerned about how it's going to raise enough money to maintain itself. We have 29,000 acres, 1,700 parks, and we spend 1/4 of 1% of the city budget on our parks. So
but sustainability in that sense is maintenance and it's operational budget and it's good management. But then you're also talking about the sustainability. I think that word sustainability, it has so many meanings, different meanings, but in terms of the ecological meaning.
Yes, all of the different kinds of things you've described are there because some of the wonderful people who decided have loved them and kept them going. And hopefully more and more people care about parks and the environment, and so hopefully we will continue to support our parks in the best way we can. That's what New Yorkers for Parks does.
Well, thank you all very much.